The most commonly used radiopharmaceuticals in pediatric patients are DMSA and MAG3 to assess the anatomy and function of the kidneys. DMSA is mainly used for the early diagnosis of pyelonephritis in children or for identifying renal scarring after recurrent urinary tract infections. If left untreated, renal scarring may lead to hypertension, proteinuria, and end-stage renal disease. DMSA is an ideal agent for the assessment of the renal cortex as it binds to the cortex with longer retention than any other agent. In pyelonephritic areas of the kidney, the uptake of DMSA will be reduced. During scar formation, the functional tubular cells are replaced by fibrous tissue that does not take up DMSA. So this test can be used during or shortly after the urinary tract infection to confirm the presence of acute pyelonephritis, or 4 to 6 months after the urinary tract infection to look for renal scarring. Let's look at an example. Before we start, know that the camera is usually placed behind the patient for imaging, so the image of the left kidney is on the left, and the image of the right kidney is on the right. This is a scan from a 6-year-old girl with known vesicoureteral reflux who had multiple urinary tract infections. So you see that this patient's right kidney is smooth and bean-shaped. The left kidney, on the other hand, is irregular. It looks as if someone took a bite of the upper pole. The lower pole is a bit irregular too. Since this is a scan from a 6-year-old girl with known vesicoureteral reflux and multiple urinary tract infections, renal scarring from chronic infection is the most likely diagnosis. Besides this, infarction, for example from an embolus, or severe atherosclerosis can also give this appearance. Many urologists would consider this to be an indication for surgical correction of reflux. In contrast to the DMSA scan, which gives a static image of the cortex uptake only, the MAG3 renogram is a dynamic study in which the perfusion into the kidneys and the drainage out of the kidneys can be followed. The tracer is excreted via both glomerular filtration and tubular excretion. This test is mainly used to detect hydronephrosis or renal tract obstruction. Sometimes Lasix is given in order to maximize urine production. This helps to demonstrate obstruction. Let me explain this. Unless the obstruction is complete, there will be some kind of drainage. If there is a partial obstruction, it may only be detected with high urine flow. So Lasix helps to demonstrate partial obstruction by maximizing urine output. This type of scan can also be used before kidney transplantation to assess the vascularity of the kidney to be transplanted or for diagnosis of complications in the recipient after transplantation. A typical renogram has 3 phases. The first phase is known as the perfusion phase, which represents the radio tracer entering the kidneys. It usually lasts about 30 to 60 seconds. The second phase is known as the tubular concentration phase, which is characterized by the radio tracer appearing in the tubules. This phase lasts about 1 to 5 minutes and a peak in the renogram represents it. The third phase is noted by a downslope in the renogram indicating excretion of the radio tracer. It usually starts at 4 to 8 minutes after radio tracer injection. The scans you will read will vary in appearance, but you should see 3 image panels. A perfusion panel, an excretion panel, and an analysis panel. Let's look at an example. Here's a renogram from a 4-year-old boy who is referred for evaluation of right flank pain. A previous ultrasound showed grade 4 hydronephrosis of the right kidney. We suspect an obstruction, but we need to confirm this. Notice that the images on the perfusion panel are a bit fuzzier than those on the excretion panel, and the time intervals are in seconds rather than in minutes. Let's take a closer look at the perfusion panel. The kidney should show simultaneous uptake. We see that both kidneys show uptake, but the right kidney doesn't get quite as bright. And when looking at the excretion panel, we see that the left kidney showed prompt excretion, but the right kidney retains the radioactive tracer, even in the last image. And lastly, we have the analysis panel. These computer-generated curves give a graphical representation of the scan images over time. The common elements you will find on any study are the curves representing early uptake and excretion, and two tables for differential function and clearance. Each kidney is plotted separately on each graph, and usually the curves show rapid uptake and rapid excretion. In this case, the right kidney shows slightly less perfusion and significantly slower excretion than the left kidney. The table on the left gives the differential function and the half-life. The differential function is the relative contribution of each kidney in relation to the total renal uptake. This should be more or less symmetrical and thus around 50%. In our case, the right kidney contributes 42.6% of total renal function, which is a bit lower than normal. The half-life is the time at which half of the radioactive tracer has drained. It should be less than 12 minutes. Our patient's right kidney has a prolonged half-life of almost 43 minutes. So all things considered, you can say that this boy has a significant obstruction of his right kidney. The most common cause of hydronephrosis in a child is a urethropelvic junction obstruction. If this turns out to be the case, a dismembered pyeloplasty should be performed to relieve the obstruction. Parents are often concerned about the radiation dose their child may receive during a scan. You can reassure them that the effective dose will be very low, especially compared to, for example, a CT scan of the abdomen. Radiation exposure from a renal scan is approximately 1 millisievert, as compared to 10 millisievert for a CT scan of the abdomen. In other words, the radiation dose of one renal scan is approximately equivalent to the exposure from 10 chest x-rays, while that of an abdominal CT is equivalent to 100 chest x-rays. Finally, no special preparation is needed for this test. The patient can eat or drink as usual. Between the injection of the radioactive tracer and the scan, there is a 3 to 4 hour delay, and the scan time is approximately 30 minutes. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you have questions or remarks, please leave a comment below.